Your father works very hard for his money, and you waste it all on records.
This is the line to see all the innovation awards at the show. Everything here will be obsolete in 3 years and have to be replaced. Keep that in mind.
Peace and love, peace and love. Don't send me any more things to sign. They will not be signed. They will be thrown away as of October 16th. Peace and love. I love you. Don't send me anything. You know what? I think if somebody sent this to Ringo, the Yellow Submarine turntable, he might relent. He might sign it. You know, he might. Or he might keep it. So take your chances. Okay, that is very, very cool. This is, you know, this is something you might want to have. I think that's very cool. Do you like that? I think it's cool. Or maybe you're saying, vinyl is jump the shark. Why would you make a turntable that look like Yellow Submarine? Okay, well, I like it anyway. Okay, we're with the inimitable Garth Lehrer, who has just hydrated for us.
Very important in the desert.
He's,
yes.
Yeah, he's got the wetness going for him. So now, what are you going to show us here?
We're going to show you all of the new products that we have here at the show.
Let's go.
We're starting out with the DS Audio DSW2, which is their next generation optical cartridge that replaces the DSW1, which was their first, kind of proof of concept product.
Right.
So the W2 uses their new, more efficient optical generator system with a more traditional wire suspension.
Right.
Which helps preserve channel separation to give higher channel separation, better stereo imaging. And their new W2 equalizer, which uses a massive power supply. It's both a single-ended and balanced circuit now. And it gives you the choice of two outputs, and the second being the most important one, the RIAA, to match all your records that you're going to be enjoying with it.
Okay.
So, and this will be retailing for $13,000 for cartridge and matching photo stage.
Okay.
Essentially, $4,500 for the cartridge and $8,500 for the photo stage. So this one has been modeled after their Master One, which is their top end, and that's the Master One photo stage way down there at the bottom.
And is it a different cartridge or the same?
A different cartridge, but they're all cross-compatible now. So the idea was to create a line of three cartridges and three phono stages.
Yes.
So it's a closed match system that has the ability to upgrade through it.
Okay.
So we're also showing the DS Audio ST50, which is their new stylus cleaning system.
Oh. And
which is based on urethane, which they use in clean rooms and semiconductor.
Right. Oh.
So you've got a special urethane pad mounted in this aluminum housing where they have a leather backing to it so it doesn't scratch your platter.
Wow. Oh, you can put it right on the, of course.
Yeah. Yeah. So you can lower it right onto the stylus and stylus right onto it. I like to emphasize that you're only using the actual downward force of the cartridge, not, you know, exerting with a brush on the stylus any additional forces or putting it in the wrong direction. And this will be $79.95.
Can you give me one of those take home?
That's a check with
Donkey.
Okay. So, but we can give you one of our new Stasis Groove Cleaner record brushes here.
Okay, I always happy to look at those and write about them.
This is a new record brush that's being imported from Asia. It's a nylon microfiber. Each fiber is about 50 microns thick. So they're very long, very narrow, so they can get deep into the groove. And if Michael wants to caress it a little bit, he can feel how soft. You can do it on your cheeks, sir.
Then it wouldn't be visible on camera.
Yeah,
so this is for this kind of cleaning.
Wet or dry. So usually you dedicate one brush for each.
Right.
Because the nylon doesn't react in any negative way to any kind of chemical solvents or alcohol or the soaps that would be typically found in record cleaning fluid.
That's
so. Also, what's nice is with the nylon brush and the resistance that it shows, unlike some carbon fiber brushes, you never have to worry about the bristles collapsing and you scratching your record with the aluminum housing. Because a lot of times when we go to clean our records, we're not really thinking what we're doing.
Right.
It's almost kind of a reactive thing.
You don't
want to
be pressing down.
Yeah. So
but you know,
nice.
In my opinion is when you're coming close to your turntable, that's time to start thinking carefully.
Be on your toes.
Be on your toes.
And what we were actually just doing is cleaning a record that's on the new Concept Active. So what we've done now is introduce the Active version, which is an $800 PhonoStage headphone amp, which is built into any Concept you want. It has to be ordered that way from the factory.
Oh, okay.
So this is the Concept with the moving coil, the Active system. This would be about $3,200. And you have the volume control here, quarter inch headphone jack.
Oh, so it's ready to play.
Ready to play. And if Mike wants to take a pause from videoing, you can take a quick listen.
Okay, I'm going to do that. Okay, so this is the Clearaudio Concept Active. And it's an all-in-one system which has a volume control. And the cartridge is, what is the cartridge?
It's the Concept Moving Coil cartridge.
Okay, Concept Moving Coil. And it's got a built-in headphone amp. But does have a line-out as well.
It does have a line-out
so you
as well.
Can,
it's a complete solution. You can have one on your desk. You can have one on your bed table. You can have one in your system.
Okay, so, and this goes for how much?
About $3,200.
Oh, wow, that's pretty good.
It's a price range of $2,600 to $4,400 because you can fit any of the Concept models with the Active circuit.
Any of the Concept models in terms of what?
Well, you have your choice of moving magnet, moving coil cartridge. Okay. This one down here, for instance, has the Baltic birch plant and the upgraded carbon fiber.
Oh, I see. I gotcha.
So on this particular one with the moving coil, you'd be looking at about $4,400. So this would be the top of the Concept Wood Active line.
Right.
So
you're basically implementing all of this range of turntables with this option of having the
an active circuit.
Cool.
Right. And now that we're down here looking at Clearaudio, this is the new Concept Black that we introduced this year, and that's with the upgraded Satisfy Black aluminum tone arm with a standard mechanical bearing. So the Concept's basically available in three different tone arms and essentially three different cartridges direct from the factory.
Because you don't want to be messing around with the stuff in your place. You
are messing around the
you
stuff.
You want it coming from the factory. Okay, is this a new thing?
Well, the new Tracer tone arm. So this is the new pivoted arm from Clearaudio.
Oh.
The arm is $2,900 retail. And when
is it available as a separate product?
As a separate product, but when purchased with the turntable, they range at around $2,000 to $2,100 when they're package priced, as we'd like to say.
That's nice.
Yep. It's a sapphire tungsten mechanical bearing. It's got all the proper offset angles built into the bearing, very important, we know. It's got a center of gravity counterweight with a micrometer adjustment to it.
Very nice.
Carbon fiber arm tube.
And what is the mounting base? It's
the standard Lin or Clearaudio 3-hole mounting base. So this is capable of being fitted to any of the tables, starting with the Performance DC. This combination would retail for $4,500.
So $2,900 for the arm.
Right.
That's
about $2,400 for the table, but when we package them together, we can do them at $4,500.
Right.
So we've always created these special packages.
Sure. Very handsome. Very, very nice looking.
That's on the Performance DC, and we're showing the black carbon version, and this would be on the Performance DC Wood. So this is the upgraded version of the Performance using a solid Baltic birch plinth that's then mass loaded to give it additional weight and vibration isolation.
Right.
Once we go to this high mass system, we go to a special, cone coupling foot, versus those are more designed to be decoupled because you need that higher mass.
Right.
Then when we step up to this is the Ovation.
And these are belt drives?
These are all belt drives.
And everything's underneath?
Underneath with the metal sub platters.
Right.
The Performance is where we start using our ceramic magnetic bearing.
Okay, and this is the Ovation Universal 9-inch. That's
that's their standard 9-inch top-of-the-line pivoted arm that we're now doing in a black carbon, black anodized finish. So its bearing is very similar, but much higher end in terms of tolerance than what we'll be seeing on the Tracer.
Yep.
So here's our, new TT5, our new entry-level arm that can be pivoted out of the way of the record, so you can
you remove your Who picture disc, and
so that's $9,500 just for the arm.
No, for the entire setup.
Oh, for the setup.
The turntable and the arm together, $9,500.
I'm slipping a little bit. It's late in the day.
Okay. Here we go to the next in this line. This is the innovation line. So on the compact, we go into a larger bearing and platter, a little bit more mass overall. We're showing this would be the same arm in silver. And then there is a universal tone arm 9-inch in the silver finish.
That's that same tone arm.
Same tone arm. Okay. Showing the variation. And then on the innovation wood itself, we're showing the 12-inch version of the universal, all in black again. And then the TT2, which is their second from the top linear arm.
So slides out of the way.
Now this one goes hinged.
Up.
Yeah,
goes
that
up.
One hinges.
I'm unhinged. Okay. And there you have it. Oh, it's got to unlock it.
Exactly, so you don't end
accidentally.
Yeah, tipping your arm over.
Yeah, you don't want to tip your arm or show your hand.
Exactly.
Okay.
The Smart Matrix Professional. This is our $1,600 record cleaner, which you can use our new Stasis brush here to apply the cleaning fluid with, and then it vacuums dry, bidirectional.
Okay, this is your basic.
That's our basic unit, and then the Double Matrix Professional Sonic, which is our all-out unit, retails for $6,000. You can go this way and you can see the two vacuum washing systems open up. You put the record on, it actually does both sides simultaneously. It uses a high-pitched frequency to actually vibrate the cleaning pads, so you get more scrubbing action.
Right.
And the articulation of the pads also helps compensate for different thicknesses of records, so you don't have to readjust the applicators.
That's good.
This is actually a de-static brush that you can use after doing the wash cycle.
So everything's done here as far as
everything's done there, and you have the option of three automatic cycles, which are like the automatic cycles on a washing machine at home, where it'll do specific amount of wash, dry, backwards, forward, all that, or you can do everything manually. Most people choose the automatic option just because you just put the record on, walk away, and come back 5 minutes later.
And it's got a cotton or permanent press cycle?
Exactly. Delicates, too.
Okay, I like it. I like it.
Okay.
Do your underwear on there, okay.
Over here in the system, we're using Wilson Sabrina's. We're actually...
That's what I used in the courtroom.
In the courtroom, okay. And here we're showing the tracer arm again. Here we have it mounted on the new white lacquer version of the Clearaudio Innovation. And we're running the tracer with the Clearaudio Goldfinger, their top-of-the-line cartridge. So we really wanted to show that this...
Now, you really have some nerve to leave that cartridge hanging out there like that in a show condition. Kudos to Garth for having...
Yeah, well, we wanted to...
It's not even guts. This is balls.
Balls, yeah, balls. Yes. Waffles.
Look, this is a $15,000 cartridge. And there's that stylus, which is exposed to begin with. You know, it's not exactly the safest thing, although you can't miss it, but you can certainly hit it by accident. Oops, sorry. Wow, and this is the DS.
This is the DS W2 cartridge with their new W2 equalizer being run balanced into the Nagra integrated classic amplifier down here.
I bet you this system sounds pretty good. Can you play something for me?
No, it doesn't work right now. No, just kidding. Of course
okay,
we can play
okay, I got some in mind.
Okay, so this is the upgraded 9W turbo arm from AMG. And this takes from the 12-inch turbo where we've taken our patented vertical bearing and done a more advanced horizontal bearing. And in addition, a larger bearing housing. And then all of the parameters for cartridge setup and can be dialed in with micrometer adjustments.
I think it's a big step up in this arm.
Yeah, a big step up.
Yeah.
A big step up in performance, a big step up in convenience.
It was a lot of fun.
We did this special limited edition in the blue anodized because it was fun.
Yes, fun is good.
So the zero combination with the standard 9-inch arm is $10,000, and with the upgraded turbo arm would be $13,500.
And is that arm available as a separate product?
That is available as a separate
product. For how much?
$6,500.
Would be nice to do some reviews.
And what's cool is the arm is actually 211 effective length, which means it's retrofittable to a Lin LP12.
Yeah,
it's very popular. That is going through this. We also have our Supernova 3, which is our top of the line musical surroundings photo stage. And it has an outboard linear charging power supply, which is the small box on top. We're actually introducing that as a standalone product for $650. And now you can add that into any of the existing musical surroundings phono stages to have extra power supply capacity.
You're very busy.
Yep, there's analog is what everybody's wanting these days. Thank to you, Michael. And you know, we want to be able to fill the market with everything that makes sense.
Fantastic.
I think we have one more new product that we haven't talked about yet, and that's the new Hana SL mono cartridge. Of course, here's the 12-inch turbo arm from AMG on the Viella.
So that looks familiar over there.
The total combination is now $22,000 in the black lacquer.
Wow.
And then we're showing next to it the Giro with the standard 9-inch arm, and that's $10,000.
Right.
So, and then over here we're showing the linear charging power supplies, which are these two components here.
Right.
And they're in the same chassis as our Phenomena 2 Plus would be, so you can actually use these two together now as an upgrade. So that complete phono system, a two box, would run, you know, roughly about, $1,400.
Okay.
And here's our display of Hana, and here's the new mono cartridge. So actually what they've done is, as you would in a mono cartridge, they've rotated the coil.
Right.
So it's only reading displacement in one direction.
Right.
It's actually a dual coil cartridge, not a single coil.
Right.
It's jumpered,
right.
Which usually is better for avoiding ground loops and interactions with different systems.
Yes.
So,
cool.
But it's based on everything that we love about the SL.
And it's
Alnico magnet.
Same price, like $900?
$700. $750.
That's good.
Yeah, so it's a very affordable mono cartridge that's a low output moving coil, which we think everybody in the industry wants.
Yes.
So, and then let's see what else we have here.
What else could there be?
Well, we have a. This is kind of a fun project we did. A special version of the concept with some interesting graphics on
skulls.
It.
Skulls.
Yeah, you know, for the headbanger and all of us. Actually, here's another concept act, and then we're showing you that would be the wood version here. So, a couple of variations on that because a lot of it.
And this is also a cleaning machine, and
just turn
here.
Just the music on
awesome.
And get ready to go.
That's great.
And in celebration of Clearaudio's 40th anniversary this year, we've created this display that traces the history of the company and shows the evolution of some of the technologies they've used in the last 40 years. And we're taking older Clearaudio parts and actually building the display that actually functions. I have to admit it. When I play a record in the vertical mode.
You can, yes, it works.
Yeah,
well,
it works. It's all working parts.
Yeah.
These are all things that have been
cool.
built by the company over the last 40 years that we've created the display for that, you know, we're going to be mounting on in some of the better stores around the United States.
Oh, you're going to make a bunch of these things.
Yeah, yeah. This is the second one. We put one already in the new Hanson's location in Cincinnati, and then this for the show.
It's very, very good looking.
Yeah.
The whole thing. I'll take a picture of that.
Yeah.
That's very good looking. Okay.
So that's pretty much it.
That's all?
That's all, yeah. You know, it's like we're doing a show, we have to have a new product, we're always developing new things, we're always finding better ways to enjoy records. That's what it's all
about.
That's
what it's all about.
Yeah, that's it.
Case, AC power. Well, we got an outlet there, we've got an outlet behind the TV, we've got an outlet over here, and your homes, your sound rooms have multiple outlets. They might be dedicated outlets, they might be in a rental that is fixed. In parts of the world, it might be 230 volts. In North America, it might be about 120 volts. 50 hertz, 60 hertz. But what is it that you really need to know about power? Why does it matter? Is it about voltage being steady? Is it about creating a perfect sine wave? Or could there be other factors at play? When it comes to AC power and an audio or video system's high performance, there are precisely two things you really, really need to focus on. The first is going to be noise dissipation, because this is going to affect every single component that you have. It doesn't matter if it's a power amplifier, it doesn't matter if it's a DAC, it doesn't matter if it's a turntable, it doesn't matter if it's a preamplifier, it doesn't matter if it's a projector. Any of these products are going to have an issue with the a level of noise that is bombarding their circuits today. In fact, there is well over 10,000 times the amount of noise airborne than there was even 30, 35 years ago. Why is that? Well, personal computer, for one. That's, you know, like basically on everybody's AC power line, and it's backwashing into all of our power. Switching power supplies, most of those power supplies are done inexpensively. They just barely pass the FCC's, you know, like regulations or the IEC's in Europe to, you know, in terms of like what they backfeed on the line. They essentially, where noise is concerned, they've destroyed everything. Even though they've been very, very convenient and have given us a lot of technologies wouldn't have had any other way. Then the other thing is airborne. Now, if we're talking about the kind of radio frequencies that we had when I was a small child, early 1960s, and certainly in my parents' or my grandparents' time, you're talking about something that was pretty simple. Shortwave, AM radio, FM radio, then later video broadcast. Certainly, you had to pay attention to this, and in those days, every good engineer, every good design, you would have shielded cable. You would have electronic components that would have a conductive metal chassis that would make sure that that radio information didn't bombard the sensitive circuits. They were right to do that. And it's important that they did. But the thing that you have to remember is that those frequencies were relatively benign and it was relatively simple. A fistful of components that fit in my hand that would cost a manufacturer like us $4, $5, $6 today. And you can do a pretty good job of not eliminating, but reducing most of that noise way too so far down to a point where it's not going to interfere with your signal. However, today, we have satellite radio. We have, and we have, you know, like satellite waves. We have cell towers. We have Bluetooth. We have so much very, very high frequency radio waves that are in every corner of this globe at this point that there's no way to escape this. And yesterday's standard shielded cable or metal chassis is just not nearly good enough, due to capacitive coupling and another number of other problems, and just the fact that these frequencies are so small. I mean, the carrier frequency for a cell tower, 2.2 gigahertz, that sine wave is so small, I could put 200 of those sine waves back to back and fit them on the side of your business card. So it's, you're really at a point now where we're gonna have to step it up and do a much better job. So I seem very animated and concerned about all this noise. Why would you care? Well, you would care because this noise is going to be induced into the circuitry, induced into the cable, induced into the AC power, and it is ultimately going to couple with your main signal. Now, the reason that that's important is because that means loss of information. Now, if we were listening to something that like an MP3 and it was slam limited, and we had 3 dB or 5 dB of dynamic range, none of this matters that much. But if we're talking about the kind of software that most of us are going to be experiencing and listening to, and we've got 60 dB of dynamic range, 80 decibels, 120 decibels, 130 decibels, well, you have a situation where you have to understand that if you look at spectrum analysis, all of those harmonics, all of those extreme highs, all of those fast transients, all the air around the instruments, the location of everything, those are all very, very different frequencies. They're all very, very different waveforms, but they have one thing in common. They're all very low in level. They are not up to the ceiling at zero dB. No, 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 no. They could be 40 decibels below, 60 decibels below, 80 decibels below, 120 decibels below. And the problem with that is that the noise used to be down here at the floor. Now the noise is up here. And what that's doing is like putting woolen blankets over your speakers.
It's doing this.
We don't want this because this is very articulate.
I want this. So how are we going to create that. That's the problem. Because if we take a look at most of the technologies that tried this, people have tried AC regeneration. They've tried isolation transformers. They've tried balanced power. They've tried various different types of filtering. They've tried all kinds of different induction devices and so forth. There's a lot of ways to go about this. And I'm not biased. I'll grab any idea that works. But there's an underlying concept that you have to understand and you have to embrace if you're going to endeavor to do this well. And that's that you better be consistent when you're unveiling the information, when you're drawing the veil away from the loudspeaker. Because if you don't do this linearly, which is just a fancy engineering term for consistently, you're going to have a sonic mess on your hands. And this is the problem with most power products and most power cables. Power cable and power product are very, very similar. I can't put all the circuitry I put into a Niagara series inside a cable, but the underlying concepts are precisely the same. They're the same problems. So what I don't want is a non-linear noise dissipation system to where I have unveiled half the tweeter range and about, you know, like a quarter of the mid-range, you know, like driver and the bass is okay. That's not good enough. I want to unveil it all. I don't want to have a situation where I have over 23 octaves of noise potential from the middle of the audio range all the way up to the lower gigahertz range to where at one octave I've lowered my noise floor by 40 decibels and I've gone to this. And then a quarter octave from there, I've only lost 10 decibels. That's better than nothing, but I've gone to this. And then an octave from there, I've got a resonant peak due to problems with impedance that I didn't plan on. And well, I did well over here, but unfortunately now, I'm at that frequency. And for 23 octaves, your average power cord and your average power product is going from, and this is also being modulated with volume, which is constantly undulating and changing with audio. It's going from this to 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 this. It's a mess.
Could you do that once
I liked it.
I absolutely could. It might not be exactly the same, but it's more or less like this. It's an illusionist trick. Now, what this is effectively like is going to the mid-1970s, finding a crown, you know, 24-band equalizer, inserting that into your system and finding a, you know, like a darling two-year-old child, you know, like from your neighborhood and said, you know, like, honey, could you please come over here and play with these knobs while I'm listening? Because that's effectively what's happening. Now, at zero VU up here at the ceiling, we haven't changed a damn thing. You can't do that with power. But that's not really what we're listening to. What we're listening to is the harmonic series, the air frequencies, the transients, the things that make this not a boombox, but a real system. And for that, that's the low level. And if we don't do that consistently, that's exactly what we're doing. We're revoicing the system, and we're doing it dynamically. We can't have a mess on our hands like that. So it's not easy to pull this off, but the whole idea is making sure that this is consistent, so that images are the right size, say stable. A voice is a, you know, like, is a circle, or, you know, like a chamber that's about 2 to 3 inches, not 10 feet. Or in an instrument such as an alto or a tenor sax or a double bass is the proper proportion in size. And as that double bass player is moving up and down the neck with different frequency ranges, it doesn't all of a sudden push off to the sides into your speaker because there's a phase or a transient, you know, like intermodulation or phase error. And that's what a lot of gear does. And that's what a lot of power products do. That's not appropriate. That's a distortion. We don't want that. That takes away that illusion that we are there. And instead of being relaxed and drawn into the music, we're constantly being jarred, you know, like awake from that. I don't want to be in that state. I want to be in a blissful state. Okay. So that being the case, that's noise. Now, there's a second thing that I talked about. And the thing that's equally important is current delivery. Now, what do I mean by current delivery? I'm not talking about average or what's called root mean squared RMS current delivery. That's child's play. Anyone can do this. That's simple. I can do this with a cheap lamp cord. I can do that with the cords that come with the system. I can do that by plugging things directly into the wall or a cheap strip. For most components, because if we're talking about a DAC CD player, if we're talking about a preamplifier, if we're talking about a projector, if we're talking about any number of different products, certainly a turntable, these are all what are called constant current power supplies. Once you turn them on, and once that power supply settles in less than a second, it's flat as can be. It's never going to move. But power amplifiers are not the same. And it doesn't matter if it's valve or solid state. It doesn't matter if it's Class A, you know, Class D, or anything in between. Yes, they're all different. It might be a linear power supply. It might be a switching power supply. They have their differences. I can go into those along with any other engineer. But what they all have in common is that every time there is a big audio slam, and all of a sudden we've gone from something very sustained and serene, and then all of a sudden maybe there's a transient. And when that happens, you know, like all of a sudden that power amplifier has to, you know, like essentially output from its power supply joules of energy, a lot through it, and they're made to do it, particularly any kind of amplifier we use in the audio file community. So it outputs all that power, and it goes out and to the speaker cable and to control the back EMF of the woofer, and it has that impact, and it works great. Now, the problem is that at that point, it's put out so much information, and its power supply works in a direct current like a battery DC condition. It, at this point, is somewhat unstable if it can't regenerate itself and get a lot of current in a hurry from the wall or from some source feeding it so that it can deal with the next transient that's about to happen. Because this system would work beautifully without any help if after that first transient it could just take a little rest. But it can't because audio keeps moving. So the idea for us is doing two things. One thing is with our cable to make sure that we have technologies that enable that current transient to be fast and efficient, unencumbered, non-compressed. There are ways to do that. And it's not just about lowering the DC resistance or having a cable the size of a fire hose that's like a spear that you can't bend. It's not just that, because it also has to do with the characteristic impedance of the cable itself. You have to look at both things. Because the characteristic impedance for a fast transient, if that characteristic impedance is too low, it's going to have an effect on that current transient that's going forward. We need to control that. Our new power cable series has no characteristic impedance, or what we call zero characteristic impedance. By zero, not 0 ohms, but effectively it's like an open. It's like a transparent cable that essentially looks, you know, like to the impedance of the source and load like it's not there. Ideal. And linear as well. Now, the other thing that we can do with the Niagara 7000 5000 is we can give you a buffer stage, not on the secondary of its power supply, which they all have and do exemplarily well, but on its primary, the input. And we can give it a current reservoir up to 25 milliseconds that'll get past even the most severe, you know, like a series of transients that might try to go through your signal. And that's effectively what we do. Those are the two principal underlying things if I'm talking about our power cables, particularly our new power cable designs, and the Niagara series. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have us first listen to this system set up with the Niagara series and the cables as I've talked about, and then we're going to listen to it a second time, same volume, same track, but the second time round, I'm going to take, and in fact with the same exact power cable, same length, but instead of going through the Niagara series with its transient power correction with almost 90 amps peak of current reservoir up to 25 milliseconds, well, we're going to get rid of that. And instead, we're just going to go directly into the wall. As most power manufacturers, or power amplifier manufacturers, excuse me, would recommend that you do. And for good reason, because most power products traditionally have made power amplifiers compress and sound worse. I'm going to demonstrate to you that no. We're about to make your power amplifier more efficient, and we're about to make it better. Same volume, same track, We're still going through the Niagara for all the source components, and all the cables are the same, same lengths. The only thing we changed is now, through the same cord, we're having the power amplifier go straight into the wall. No transit power correction, no Niagara. Happened. Let's see. The room just fell apart. The bass is uncontrolled, and you know, like, just basically, it's like falling apart with every transit. And the top end, we've just lost an octave, and we've lost all the definition, and the whole thing is distorted and smearing because we don't have the filter, we don't have the ground noise dissipation, and mainly, we're not giving the power supply the current it needs on demand when it needs it. We're not buffering it. It needs that. We're going to accomplish that. Okay, we're gonna put in underwater folk singer, and let's just listen to, you know, like about 30 seconds to a minute of this track, and then we'll listen to the bottom of the new Storm series and see what differences we detect. Essentially a $4 to $5 cord from China, and it sounds like it. This would be our current entry level into, again, the Storm series, the Thunder. Move up the line to, from here, the tornado, then the hurricane, then the dragon source. But I'm not going to do that.